Living Seed Media brings to you God's Word, which is His comprehensive equipment for changing lives. May the Lord impact your heart as you encounter His Word. For further inquiry or counsel, contact Peace House, P.O. Box 971, Boko, Benue State, Nigeria. Telephone numbers 0703-036-3659, 0703-768-1198. Email address lsmedia@livingseed.org or visit our website at www.livingseed.org. Let us sit back and listen as the servant of God brings forth the word of life.
Normal Christian. The imperatives of a normal Christian. And in the first part, which will be all the parts we can take this morning, we'll be looking at the imperative of living for eternity, which should be a clear, identifiable, and invariable mark accompanying a normal Christian. The imperative of living for eternity. Would you like to open in your Bibles to Colossians chapter 3. I would request us to read from verse 1 to verse 11. If then you were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is, sitting at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on things on the earth. For you died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, appears, then you also will appear with Him in glory. Therefore, put to death your members which are on the earth: fornication, uncleanness, passion, evil desire, and covetousness, which is idolatry. Because of these things, the wrath of God is coming upon the children of disobedience, in which you yourselves once walked when you lived in them. But now you yourselves are to put off all these: anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy language out of your mouth. Do not lie to one another, since you have put off the old man with his deeds and have put on the new man, who is renewed in knowledge according to the image of Him who created him, where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcised nor uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave nor free, but Christ is all and in all. Let us pray together. Our Father, you have done it over and over again before, opening our understanding to behold the mysteries of life out of the pages of the Holy Scriptures, granting us to touch you as your word is unveiled unto our hearts, and to also receive grace that transformation work may be accomplished in us and we may become more and more like you would have us be in the image of your Son Jesus. Even so, this morning, here we come again, waiting upon you and upon your word, asking that you do it again, as by your Spirit, that as we turn over unto you, the veil might be removed, that with open face, the face of our very spirits, we will see very plainly the imagery of Scripture that should bring to us the very life and personality of your Son. We just ask that you will do an eternal work in our lives this morning by the ministry of your word and by your visitation unto us by your Spirit. Be thou exalted forever and ever, for we do thank you for answering us, because we do ask this in the name of our Lord Jesus. Amen. The imperatives of a normal Christian. Things which should go without saying for a person who actually is like Christ, because was born in his image and in his likeness, a normal Christian. And the first of the imperatives, the imperative of living for eternity. I'd like you to note that the very first verse says, if then you were raised with Christ. The King James says, if ye then be risen with Christ. The old King James. If then you were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is, sitting, rested, and at home at the right hand of God. I would like to ask you to examine in this matter if you are normal, and if there is evidence of malady, there is evidence of unwholesomeness, it will serve us well here as we come before the great physician to open up to him and to submit to his treatment, that he might make us whole and bring us back to normalcy. The Bible says, if then you were raised with Christ, if indeed you have shared in his resurrection life, then it is to be expected as normal with you to live your life seeking those things which are above, where Christ, whom you claim you were raised with, whose life you claim to share, is seated and is well at home and is content to abide there at the right hand of the throne of God. The only life into which we are born in Christ is eternal life. You remember the Bible says in 1 John chapter 5 and in verse 11 that, and this is the witness that God has borne concerning his Son, that he has given to us eternal life, and that this life is in his Son. He that has the Son has this life. He that has not the Son of God does not have life. And yesterday night we saw that it is this life that is actually life. And our stepping into it is our stepping into life. But we must note that this life is a very, very peculiar life. It is eternal life. So it is the life that issues from the eternal Godhead. And it is a life that when you possess it, you are actually possessing the qualities of eternity in you. It is a life that is conscious of eternity. And it's a life that is actually pursuing eternal values. It is a life that dwells and operates temporarily in time. But it is focused and it is purpose-driven on eternal issues. It weighs the value of things and only minds or gives attention to such as carry the weight of the usefulness of eternity. So while operating temporarily here in time, we yet live for eternity if we possess eternal life. If we possess eternal life in this present time, we live as strangers and as pilgrims. We operate as people who are on an urgent time-related assignment, who are here to accomplish a duty that is timed. And so we are passing through here with an ever-abiding consciousness of the reason for our being here and of when we will be returning back to give account. Whatever therefore is irrelevant to eternity is irrelevant to eternal life, and therefore irrelevant to whosoever is possessing eternal life. Whosoever has the Son and actually has life. Whatever, it is obvious to us that back home, where Christ, with whom we are raised, is seated, the matter does not carry weight. It is not rated to attract any importance. A person who is possessing eternal life, we attach not a single measure of value to such a matter. The only life we have in Christ, if we are in Christ at all, is eternal life. If at all a life is raised and he is normal, he has not become diseased, he has not become inflicted with some very serious infirmity of the spirit, if he is not in a state of decay or death, the Bible expects that the same things that concern Christ should be the things that concern our lives. First and foremost, because that is the life we carry. This is an imperative of a normal Christian. When a person's life is not so defined, a lot has gone wrong already. In fact, you are feared dead. Or at least you are in a very terminal point of some very serious malady. The Bible says if you were actually raised with Christ, if you claim that you have enjoyed the resurrection power of Jesus and that you share in that life that he came to offer to as many as receive him, then you cannot reasonably be expected to mind anything different from what concerns every carrier of eternal life. You cannot rationally be expected to be living for what Jesus is not living for. That even though operating in time, it should be clear by what life you carry what concerns you. And I want us to quickly begin to check if this imperative, this certain and obvious characteristic of a normal Christian, is what you observe in your personal life. Are you normal? And you know, when you are struggling to get an abnormal man to do a normal thing, as zealous and as well-intentioned as you may be, you'll be sweating over that life for nothing because you are flogging a dead horse. Don't you think we should address, first of all, the issue of our restoration to normality? Can you ask a person who is already paralyzed left and right by stroke to stand up and carry a pew for you and help you move it to where you need it to be dropped? That would be ridiculous. And if you got offended over it, And you began to rebuke him and to even flog him for not arising quickly. Actually, you are the one that should be sanctioned for behaving very strangely, because the fellow is not in his normal strength and in his normal standing. Something has gone wrong. If he will help you carry a pew, you must first address the problem of his abnormal condition. And you see, I feel that there is a labor of teaching abnormal people that amounts to flogging dead horses. There is a struggle. You personally are struggling to attain to what God expects you to be, that amounts to a worthless effort, when the issue of whether what Scripture expects of your life as a normal child of God is not first of all addressed. And you see, we have to visit this, because for many of us, we have settled down with the abnormality as what is normal. We have confused the unholy for the holy. We cannot distinguish the pure from the impure. And we have replaced the normal with the abnormal. And we regard it as what is the normal thing to do as a child of God, at least in Nigeria. And maybe particularly, at least if you are in the East. We thought that heaven is also shifting and adjusting the expectation of God regarding what our lives ought to be if we are to fulfill his purpose in the earth as his normal children. We need to address this morning and to present ourselves in prayer over it. But to do that with understanding, we need to look at the issues that will provide the relevant insight into what leads to the abnormality of you're not focusing on what Jesus focuses on, or at least not being permanently concerned with what concerns him, and being often distracted here and there and troubled about many things which actually should never concern eternal life wherever it dwells. Please note particularly that first verse said, if ye then be risen with Christ. With. Of course, every provision that the Father has made for us, we receive it in Christ. It is in him that we are all that we are. So even our resurrection life, we obtained it in Christ. But not particularly that the life came to us with him. What is the meaning of that with? And I just pray you will catch the relevance of that word with, because it is repeated through Scripture. Let me ask you to check it quickly in Ephesians chapter 2. And I want you to note from verse 4 of Ephesians chapter 2, we just take it a little down to 7, just to note the width to understand the relevance of it and how it should help our understanding of this imperative. But God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, has, you know, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. And raised us up together with who? Yes, you can understand that. Together with Christ. And made us sit together with who? With Christ in heavenly places. In Christ. Do you understand the in that is there? For all things that become us are in him. But particularly, God has given us the experience of the resurrection life, the eternal life, together with Christ. And he has caused us to be raised up with him and to be seated together with him in heavenly places, far above all principality and power and every name that is named and every throne and every dominion, with him. That with him is saying that the same greatness of power that God demonstrated to break Jesus free from the grip of death when he was buried, to release him from the power of hell and of death when he was put in the grave and his spirit went to Hades, as the Bible tells us, that the greatness of his power with which God demonstrated when he raised Jesus from the dead, it is with that same power he has delivered us from our old life of death into eternal life. He has raised us together with Christ, which means what the Father is seeing as capable in Christ's life, he expects it to be equally capable in our lives. In the matter of the resurrection life, Christ is the first fruit. We are raised in the same manner as he was raised. With the same power that raised him, we are delivered. And we are expected to live the same life. That as he is in heaven, so we ought to be in this present world. That we is saying there should be no excuse that the commitment of Jesus to the purpose of God the Father and to the establishing of his kingdom should be anything more than mine. We were raised together with him. I was raised together with him. And as I'm standing here with you, actually, my spiritual standing, the potential God has placed at my disposal, is at the same level of ability to do well as that which Jesus has. That width He's saying we have a reference that was not favored beyond you and I, and should never be expected to have done better. Otherwise, there is an obvious query upon my life and perhaps yours. If ye then be raised with Christ. Now, this is telling me that if my life is not lived for eternity, I am myself querying the fact that I was raised with Christ at all. If then you were raised with Christ, as you claim, they seem to say. How can a person actually be raised together with Christ and still condescend to living on the lowly issues of this temporal life? Maybe his claim is false. Or maybe he dropped at a point. Maybe there was a dangerous fall from grace to grass. But if now, as I speak, you be risen with Christ, we should expect nothing different than what Christ himself is concerned with where he is seated. Because the same life he carries is the life you should carry if you are raised together with him. Is there a question on your life whether really you were raised with Christ? And don't you think you should address it and not patch it up, and hope that somehow you may smuggle your way into eternity and be all right? Don't you think, as long as the opportunity of encountering the healer, the savior, the deliverer is available unto us, we should lay hold of the skirt of his garment and call out unto him, Son of David, have mercy on me. Son of David, don't let me escape your help this time around. I can't even explain what is wrong with me, but it's obvious I'm not normal. It's obvious that this is not your expectation of those who are raised with you. But you know, as we came a little bit down, we came across an explanation when in verse 3 of that Colossians 3, the Bible said, For you died. Now, note this, that it's only the dead that can be raised. Resurrection is not available for the living. So only those who experience death can experience also the resurrection. That's the first clue. Maybe all along you never died. But you really like the resurrection, but you hate that dying aspect. Well, that's all right. We appreciate your feelings. But if you don't die, if you have never died, resurrection is not a possibility for you at all. For you died. He's saying, look, if you will be really, really counted among those who are raised, you must first have died. You must first have experienced death in your life. Has your life really at a point genuinely recorded death? death that has made all of your aspirations and expectations and all the desires of both your friends and family to be brought to an obituary. And everybody had to realize that, sorry, that life has ended. We've lost him. And when they speak of you, are they really quietly able to say, our late son who is sitting here? Because as a matter of fact, they can't really expect you to be what they were expecting you to be again. That life was lost. For you died. For you died. Now, do you remember that in John chapter 12, where I think we could just nail this issue, beginning at verse 24 and 25, just those two verses of John 12, we saw Jesus making the point very, very emphatically. He said, most assuredly, I, Jesus, say to you, and I am the way, the truth, and the life. Unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it produces much grain. He who loves his life will lose it. And he who hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. I am afraid of certain patterns we see in the dealings of God in the lives of men. I'm afraid that God could come down and bring an understanding that is a very, very powerful help to bring his divine work to be accomplished on the lives of people. But over time, people get familiar with the mode of God's visitation, and they actually become peddlers of that mode of God's visitation, but they miss the visitation itself. There are many of us preaching new creation life who have missed the new creation life. Genuinely a visitation by God. But over time, it is merely becoming a very, very wonderful language. A very, very impressive manner of presenting the challenge of living right. Why the actual divine visitation that it was meant to accomplish is quietly being missed by the very same hands that are eagerly carrying it about. So don't be offended if I ask you again, not whether you are a new creation life or let's use another language. Do you love your life? Then it's a pity. You have no part in eternal life, says Jesus. Have you really, really come to the point where you hated your life to the point of sentencing it to the cross of Christ? And it was not a mere form, it was a reality. He who loves his life will lose it. before you died. The Bible says, they that are Christ, those who belong to Christ, they are people who have crucified their life, their human life, all their human opportunities, all their human goals and aspirations and potentials. They have crucified it with all of the affections and lusts that attend all the wonderful possibilities that follow on the cross of Christ. Except a grain of corn fall into the ground and dies, however zealous it is to belong to the fresh crop of corn that will spring up in the new life. Now, Lio is just the deceiving servo. It abideth alone. But if it dies, that's when the miracle of God, the miracle of resurrection, with its attendant multiplicity of glorious blessings that follow, will attend such a life. But there's another point I want you to note. I've finished with John 12. I only wanted to point that out to nail a matter in, because I want us to be praying shortly. I want you to note verse 1 of that chapter 3 of Colossians, which is our text, our main text, says, if then you were raised with Christ. But look again at verse 3. For you died. You were raised. You died. The raising, it is God that takes care of it. The dying is our business. You die. Look, once you die, you will be raised. You are worrying about how to be raised. Is that your business? If only you concentrated on ensuring that you die. The raising is what God does. You will never see anywhere where the Bible says, for you were killed. Have you ever come across, for you were killed? Jesus is the resurrection and the life. He does not have the ministry of killing. He came not to kill, but to give life. Unfortunately, he can only give life to those who have died. So he made every provision for our dying. But he can't put his finger to do it. And if you don't take advantage of the provision voluntarily, so that you, on account of your choice, will die, as eager as our master is to give us life and to give it more abundantly, you'll be running around Jesus, not knowing eternal life in your own soul. And he himself is waiting eagerly as the resurrection and the life. That if only you died, he will raise you up again. Note, don't begin to say, oh God, kill me, when we start praying. Please God, I want to die. Knock me on the head. Sorry for you. It will knock you nowhere. If you want to die, provision for you to die, the grace for God to take away the concerns of your present life, which you are serving in the oldness of your human nature. It is handled when you are ready. But you are the one to crucify your flesh with his affections and lusts. Don't start begging Jesus to become a killer. Then they'll be saying, it's Jesus that killed our daughter. And he said he's the savior. He came to give life. See, he has killed my daughter now. No. Not my Jesus. No matter how you beg him, he will have nothing to do with your dying. But if you see the benefit of a grain of corn that must die, because he has the hope of an abundance of glorious multiplication of power awaiting him if only he died. And he said, but what am I protecting? What is it I'm holding on to? Is it a ministry that I thought is something? Is it a name I thought I have? To abide like this and to be what I will become in the resurrection. Which one is better? And you yield yourself to his death. You subscribe your life to his death on the cross on our behalf. And let go once and for all. I will say shortly thereafter, for he that will come, will come. He will surely come, he will not tarry. But if he tarry, wait for him. He never fails. But that death must be before the resurrection. Could this be the reason why you have been wondering why your life is never correct? Could it be you are claiming to be raised with Christ when Christ is saying, but when did you die? Or could it be you were actually raised at a point, but some terrible accident of sin has knocked you out? So what to expect of a living strong life in Christ doesn't come forth from you. You are sleeping among the dead. Won't you come to the great physician who is here in person to say, Lord, I came for a thorough checkup, for a help that is comprehensive. If I'm going to be put on intensive care for the next 10 years, it's better for me because I have a glorious hope in view. But I don't intend to remain abnormal and be finding many excuses to explain it away, as many of us do very eloquently. I want to be what the Bible says you would have me be. I want my own focus, my own expectations, my values to be set on eternity. I want to be eternity driven. I want to live a life that befits eternal life in a person. I don't want to be making a claim of what is not obvious. Nobody actually sees it in me. I don't want to be a contradiction of terms. I don't want to be a false claim. I don't want to keep impersonating the life of Christ when I really don't carry it. If it is that I never actually experienced that death, and I thought I did, are you not still here? You must help me this morning. I think we could pray on this as the challenge of this morning, as a point of approaching unto God regarding our state. The Bible said, if ye then be risen with Christ, why is your life like this? Why are you always struggling with worldliness? Why are you always falling into sin? Is that how God intended it to be? Christ that was raised with you, is that how he keeps falling into sin? Or was it a different power that raised him? Wouldn't you say, Lord, I am tired of being a contradiction? If it is the same you that saves to the uttermost those who come to God by you, and you are here, why won't you change my condition as I cry upon you now? For the Bible says, as many as will call upon the name of the Lord, what will happen to them? They shall be saved. Are you ready to call upon the name of the Lord this morning? Let us pray together, if you are. If not, please ignore me. If there is a matter to call upon the name of the Lord, won't you join me to call upon his name indeed? For the Lord is here in our midst. And it's as many as we call upon his name that shall be saved. Not one extra, not one less, as many. Will you be counted among those many who are saying, cause my life to record this imperative. At least in this matter, let there be no iota of doubt that I stand normal as your child, as a Christian, as a correct believer. Help me in this one matter, and help me definitely. Will you need to show me the cross that I may bring my life to that cross and deliver it to be crucified, ready to take the pain and the shame? Or is there a crash I suffered after visiting the cross and I need some repair? I ask that you will show me mercy this morning and attend to me as the condition of my life may require. Pass me not, O gentle Savior, hear my humble cry. Savior, while on others thou art calling, Savior, do not pass me by. Hallelujah. Savior, hear my humble cry. Hallelujah. While on others thou art calling, Savior, do not pass me by. Oh, Savior, hear my humble cry. Hear my humble cry. Why, Lord, others thou art calling? Savior, do not pass me by. I want you to pray as God may have given you understanding. Sitting with him. With him we must be seated. Where we are seated is where our concern will be. That's where our own interest will lie. That's where our attention will be taken. That's where our priorities will be defined. We will be living for eternity. We'll be pursuing the things which are not seen, but are eternal. And we will be all right because we have eternal life. This is our life. The things that matter to a pig are not the same things that matter to a goat or a sheep. Lord, we ask that a heart that is focused on the things that concern our life in Christ, eternal things. This must be our portion, that we might walk in normalcy. We may conduct ourselves in normalcy. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Few things I want you to quickly pray about. The Bible said, what seek ye? What really, really is your heart looking for in Christ? The Bible said, if you be risen with Christ, it is the things which are above you will seek. And he specifically said, we must seek not the things which are on earth. He didn't say we should seek both the up and the down. Are you trying to combine seeking up and down at the same time? Were you hoping to be very smart to balance the two wonderfully and serve two masters and offend none? Won't you this day also submit that aspect to death? That whatever I could possibly become on earth, it is given up now. I don't care what the earth expects of me anymore. I yield my interest in whatever portion this present life has to offer me. Everything I do must concern how I gain eternity. How I gain eternity. And the God of eternity will know how to keep me in time. That's how it should be. Would you like to say, Lord, break this aspect of my heart that has been a conflict in me? Maybe that's where I didn't die and the thing no work for me. I thought that I should be able to make it here as I'm making it over there. And the Bible is saying, don't even set your mind on anything here at all. Will you really, really go with Jesus? Here is the point of decision. Here is the practical matter to resolve. Must you care for the things of this life? Then you will lose Jesus. For he is already seated above. Is not coming down to mind the matters of the earth. He has rested and he doesn't regret that he never married. He's not regretting that he never had a child, a biological child of his own. He's never regretting that he had no house of his own, not even a rented room to his name. He's rested there, not minding that he doesn't have a title of the earth. Will you really, really go with Jesus? Will you really, really, really live eternal life? Maybe you should decide if this is not the life you wanted, so that you don't gather just to make up huge numbers for us. If there were three sincere brothers who are really meaning business, how we would have settled down on them? But you made everything look so big to us. We don't know who to face even when we are preaching. If you really didn't mean to go to this extent, why don't you tell God, I'm sorry for wasting your time. I really belong to the world. And I'm going back now. We will still be praying for you, but we will know whom we are focusing on now. And we are praying ourselves that that will not be our own portion. Lord, show us mercy this morning and grant us relevant understanding as we press on further in the course of this day, both praying and searching the scriptures. Be thou exalted forever and ever. Thank you, Father. Blessed be thy holy name forevermore. In Jesus' name we have prayed.